I am the mighty Caleb Valhalla, and this is SWN. Skull! Skull! Skull!
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. And even though technical difficulties try to intervene, I am joined by the Scandinavian dragon, Aliss Ink. Welcome to the show.
Thank you so much. Thank you so much for having me. It's a pleasure.
I'm excited to have you on. I noticed that you've kind of been following our Twitter for a while, and I've been kind of waiting. I've been waiting for a Scottish for a match for you, having Scotland going, right, now she's had it, let's get her on the show. Let's just get her in onto the show. Because I was kind of made aware of you through Kurt Johansson did his ScandiGraps series, and your name kind of came up and during that as well. So your name's been around that I've noticed for a wee while. So I'm glad that I've now got a reason to get you on my show here.
No, and I finally got to make my Scottish debut, and I'm super happy about that, because that's actually it's one of the places I've really been looking forward to. So shake the first match off, and hopefully there'll be more in the future. So
perfect. Well, we'll probably get into that a little bit. I like to try and do things as much as I can in timeline order, so we will get to that probably nearer the end. But we'll start right at the beginning. Probably the most common question you'll ever get asked as a wrestler, and also one that we got in from CM_Punk_Sweden on Instagram, something of a similar vein. What got you into wrestling? And his question is, or sorry, their question is, first memory of watching wrestling on TV. So what got you into wrestling?
I mean, I didn't come into wrestling really as a fan. I knew what wrestling was. I'd watched maybe a couple matches, a show. I knew who Undertaker was. That was kind of my wrestling knowledge to the point when I started training. I had quite an extensive martial arts experience coming into wrestling, and focused a lot on that at the time. A friend got me to join a couple live shows in Stockholm, which I thought was really entertaining. Did not consider the fact that I was going to be doing this a little bit further down the line, but it was a lot of fun. Then she called out maybe half a year after the last show we went to, and was like, "Do you want to try wrestling with me?" I was like, "Yeah, why not?" I mean, it's always fun to try new stuff, right? I didn't understand that she actually asked to bring me to a tryout. That thought did not cross my mind at all. So we show up to this testing day, as I assumed it was. And it was a 5-hour tryout, and I had so much fun and love it for a bump. That's kind of what it was. and I have not looked back since.
So coming from a martial art background, then, was there always, I mean, I always kind of imagine, maybe not so much now, but was there a little bit of pro wrestling was the fake stuff? It was the stuff you turned turned your nose up at, because it's, you're doing real fighting, whereas that's kind of the entertainment side of things. Was there any backlash when you decided, yeah, I want to try and give this a go because of that?
It's a common, it's not uncommon in martial arts to have that opinion about wrestling, I'd say. I've come across it quite a few times, but not. The club I come from is very open-minded with things, just in general. Mm-hmm. The trainer I had at the time, and still have when I have the time to go to the dojo, unfortunately not so often as I wish, but he's actually, he's one of the people that's always been rooting for me in the wrestling world as well, and he thinks it's super fun. He loves the flashy stuff. I mean, he and a lot of the ideas that I actually bring into wrestling come from the martial art I have been doing beforehand, just spice it up a little bit extra, obviously for the crowd. But it is, I always had good support in the martial arts community as well. But as you're saying, it is, it's not uncommon for people to, it is rigged, right? I mean, it's not for real. And maybe a little bit, nose up the air for it, kind of. But I'd say it's not too bad. In Sweden, though, wrestling was not really a thing when I grew up. Mm-hmm. It was late night TV on a TV channel that most people didn't have. very few actually followed wrestling. I didn't know anyone. Wrestling was not, there wasn't anything that you talked about. I mean, some people obviously played the games and had that as a hobby, but it's not something you came across.
Yeah,
It was
so.
like the odd newspaper article, unfortunately, about the tragedies made it to Sweden. But apart from that, it was kind of an unknown at the time for me.
Right, yeah, because I've had a couple of Scandinavian guests on in the past, and that seems to be quite a common thing. It's, if it's the video games, you're lucky if you see anything, and if you do, and then YouTube became a thing, and
Yeah.
then that's kind of when you got into wrestling more. So when it comes to that love at first bump thing, then just for my own timeline here, how many tattoos did you have at that point? Because you must have a high tolerance for pain, not only doing martial arts, but I've seen the photos on Instagram, I've seen the how many tattoos you have, and I'm just like, yeah, you must be just pain must mean nothing to you.
I mean, I don't enjoy pain, but I can tolerate it, if you know what I mean. It's but yeah, it's means to an end. Pain is there. You stick through what you decided on doing, and same with tattoos, same with wrestling, same with martial arts. You make up your mind and then you go for it. So but yeah, some of the tattoos have been super painful. Quite a few, as you pointed out. But that's life. Life isn't always you have to put yourself through things as well to get where you want to go somewhat sometimes.
So
And I always love tattoos, and I always since I started with the wrestling, I just love doing it. And yeah, some things are gonna hurt, and you have to decide, is it gonna hurt just for now? Then it's fine. It's gonna be long-term damage, obviously. That's a different beast, but try not to think about that too much, I'd say.
I mean, much like well, tattoos and wrestling, I suppose it's an addiction as well because of that positive outlook you have on it, going, well, if we're kicking each other for 10 minutes, then but at the end the crowd cheers or on their feet, then it's fine. That's what it was worth doing that 10 minutes of doing it. Same with tattoos. If you're in for a, I don't know, 3 hour session, but at the end you get to see the finished masterpiece and work, then it's all worth that kind of thing. For myself,
Exactly.
I keep forgetting how painful tattoos are until I book the next one, and then it gets started, and I'm going, why did I forget this? How did I forget this? And then in the end, I'm like, oh, it was really nice. And then next day, wonder where I'm gonna get my next one. Let's book another one in. It's just one of those very weird things.
Yeah.
I've stuck to the arms. I'm not going anywhere else because I don't have a high pain threshold. That's enough for me. That'll do. I'll stick there. But just seeing the back
Some
and all that. Oh.
places on the arms as well, like, you know, in the armpits and so on.
Mm-hmm.
It's not very nice. It really isn't. But yeah.
Yeah, you get to see it at the end, and it's just yeah, like I say, it's art at the end of the day. So we're gonna go right again back to the start. We talked about how you got into wrestling and how you actually became into wrestling. You end up being conned into a 5 hour tryout, and somehow you're still here in the end of it, and your friend's still, I assume, a friend, even though they threw you into the deep end straight away.
Yeah,
2018,
she
I've got is.
is not wrestling at the point though. She's still doing martial arts. So,
Right.
but I
Okay.
have everything to thank for her bringing me to that tryout. So,
So not only did she throw you into the deep end, but then she went, no, you can leave it. You can do it yourself now. Well, I'll just we'll go to I'll stick to the
well,
martial
it was basically, yeah, great, have fun. I don't have time for this.
arts.
So I was like, okay. But no, I had so much fun. I made so many like friends as well, in not just in Sweden, obviously in the wrestling community here, but all around the world. So I'm super grateful.
So I've got your debut down as 2018, a tag team match with your team with Ender Kara. So when you found out that you were making your debut, whether it was that match or cage match is completely wrong, did you feel like you were ready for it? Or were you just again thrown in the deep end? You were told the night before you're making your debut. What was the kind of situation there?
I did not feel ready for it. I'm still not sure I'm always ready for it, if you know what I mean. Wrestling is such a process. Some aspects, I mean, I had so much with me from the martial arts as well. And obviously being the first match, and for quite in it was a family show, and obviously all of the people in the match was people I knew, so it was a really good first match to have. But yeah, it's I mean, I trained for about half a year at that point, which is not a long time. I mean, I started training at the somewhere along the February, I think, in 2018. I did my first match, and I think it was the start of summer. So the time span in between there, I mean, I'd say most people should probably train longer than that before doing their first match. But I mean, it's a small scene. It's also lack of females, obviously, as it is in a lot of places around Europe. So yeah, you get ushered into it quite quickly. But it has worked out pretty well for me. I got a lot of support and obviously a good background as well too that I can kind of lean on when I feel I'm in deep waters. Like, well, I can still bring a lot of the martial arts stuff that I have been doing for so many years beforehand. So I can kind of make it work. But it is tough sometimes. And wrestling knowledge-wise as well, obviously, since I haven't watched wrestling growing up, it's so much apart from just the moves and just like the ring work that you need to understand and get a grasp of. And that's still something always adding on, always trying to learn. I mean, I'm still in my rookie years, if you ask me. Just had a very, very good run so far with my rookie years.
I suppose, and then there's thrown in a pandemic in the middle of it, just to spice it up. So yeah, you said that your knowledge is still fairly fresh in your rookie year. So you mentioned Undertaker as someone that you saw. Was there anyone that you were kind of told to check out online or whatever to help you to
Oh,
bridge
definitely.
that
And I
gap?
mean, absolutely. I got so many good recommendations early on as well. People to look at, people to so many different ones. I mean, Malachi Black was one of the early ones that was kind of like told to look at. Obviously, since this was I started wrestling at the same time Ronda Rousey came into the picture as well. Regardless what you think about her as a wrestler, it's kind of like a lot of people made that comparison as like try to move me into kind of like the MMA wrestler type category quite early on as well. So, and obviously Io Shirai as well in the Japanese or the work she did in Japan before moving to the US and so on. So I got a lot of good recommendations. I mean, and along the way I found other ones obviously that I mean Daniel Danielson is one of my absolute favorites to watch. I really like Loki as well, how he works in the ring, and Rob Van Dam is also like making everything look gritty. In a way, it's clean, but it's not clean, if you know what I mean.
Yeah, it looks real, or as real as it can be.
Absolutely, but there's so many, and I share a pick a lot because everything was kind of introduced at the same time. So I share a pick from different ages, different eras. I obviously like the striking styles a lot when it's like hardcore striking, but also I do like the flying and the lucha and different spices from different places. It's kind of like cooking a stew. You want different influences, different textures. Try to make something that's going to be hopefully a phenomenal finished product, whenever that's going to be. Probably never. No one's ever finished, right?
I mean, as a fan, there's some people you think, oh, they're the finished article already. But yeah, I suppose as someone that's doing it themselves, you're probably, I don't know if you've watched back many of your matches, but you're probably one that'll sit down and just go, no, I could do that better. I could do that better. I could do this instead. And
Always. I mean, even as matches I'm super happy with and I know they went well, I got very good feedback from them, I always pick them apart. It doesn't matter. I will pick anything apart that I'm a part of. But I think that's important as well to never settle for anything. You always want to get better. If you don't have that drive, then I think with anything in life, if you don't have the drive to get better at something, you obviously can do things for pure enjoyment, right? But if it is something you want to excel at, you should always keep working at it. Otherwise, there's no point in doing it. And the day I wake up and feel like I have nothing more to learn in wrestling, I'll probably quit. Or maybe start helping other people, possibly. But I mean, I don't think I'll reach that point when I feel like I'm done with learning. I think there's always going to be something new around the corner.
so especially if you've got goals and aspirations and AEW Japan and WWE, wherever you end up or want to be, it's you got to add so many quivers to your bow and all that kind of thing. I do have it seems like a big jump now. My next note was things like ScandiGraps, because you did you have matches everywhere And you said you're 6 months in when you first started, so you're still kind of learning on the job as it goes. But you got some big opportunities pretty quickly when it came to wrestling, things like the ScandiGraps tournament. I was noticing
Absolutely.
who you beat, like Ender Kara, who mentioned that you tag team with, Hanyadi Tamash, who we spoke to before this podcast, and Carlos Zamora, who, if I remember rightly, he had the WWE tryout. So that's a pretty big list of competitors.
Absolutely. I was terrified, to be honest. I mean, it was also straight out of the pandemic, more or less. So, and wrestling training opportunities had been extremely scarce in Stockholm. We didn't have a place to have the ring out for trainings for the entire pandemic. I think I went one show before the ScandiGraps, just which I'm very, very happy that that opportunity existed, just getting into the ring a little bit to feel like how was it to run the ropes. I was taking a proper bump. Obviously, we tried getting trainings, but it was on judo mats. So we borrowed a place in a dojo to do some, at least what we could do safely. But it's not the same. You need a ring to train wrestling properly, and get the distance, get the footing and everything, and try to like figure out how the movements is gonna work in real life. So yeah, ScandiGrap was super scary in that aspect, and also, I mean, obviously, taking a chance of putting me in that tournament, I'm extremely grateful to Body Slam for that, because that kind of became a stepping stone for to reaching a lot of other markets, and people got their eyes on me, I'd say, from that tournament. So, yeah, that was a really huge thing. One of my absolute still favorite matches, the finale against Carlos Zamora is like one of my all-time favorites still. So, and I think that holds up, even if I still, like I said, I nitpick at it, obviously. I could have done that better. I could have been a little bit faster. I could have been a little bit cleaner there. But that's just what wrestling is. And not everything is going to work exactly as you want it to, but you need to push through and you need to make it the best you can do in the moment, obviously. That's always what it's about.
Absolutely. So speaking of the pandemic thing, because a lot of, like you said, there was nothing. There was nothing training. It was mostly online stuff if you were able to do online things. And I know Luke and Sharp did his online dojo. How did you kind of keep yourself preoccupied during that time, as an athlete, or just trying to, was it just studying? Was it just more study work instead? Or how did you keep yourself occupied during that?
I mean, it was a lot of watching wrestling, trying to catch up on things, and I watched a lot of old wrestling at the time as well, trying to like we're older, trying to understand how the product evolved as well. But yeah, and I obviously I trained like a maniac. Actually, just before the pandemic, I actually ripped my stomach in the ring. So I had an operation just before, like a week before the pandemic closed down everything in Stockholm. Very lucky that was before, not after, because that would have been terrible, most likely, being hospitalized during that period. So I obviously had some recovery to do anyway. So in that, if you look at that specific thing, the timing was quite good for me. It's like, okay, nothing is going on now anyway. I'm actually not missing out. I wouldn't have been able to do these shows anyway. But then when the pandemic started to drag on, it's like, okay, it's not just a month, it's 2 months, 3 months, it's a year, it's one and a half. It's like, yeah, obviously that was a completely different ballpark. But yeah, I trained a lot. I got through the recovery period quite nicely. Got very quickly back into training, and loads of just trying to build the body up as good as possible for wrestling. And thinking more along those lines. I still did a bit of martial arts training, but obviously, all types of trainings were kind of hard at that point. Not just wrestling, martial arts as well. So it wasn't a lot of that going on. But I had good people around me to keep me occupied. So, and like I said, a lot of watching wrestling, and I think that helped me a lot as well.
It's one of those
But it's
things
a
during
lot.
that time. It's one of those things during that time, unless you literally live with someone who did wrestling or would help work out. It was a case of, yeah, just having to try watch or go out for a run and avoid people and all that. But yeah, it was just one of those weird times that I don't know. We're still probably going to see the after effects of. Well, probably still are. 3 years on, is
Oh,
it?
Absolutely. And I'm thinking as well for the kids that grew up in that period and had like substantial things in their lives, like around the early teens, for example, during the pandemic, or young children not getting the social, maybe the social development as quickly as other kids forget, and so on. So I think there's a lot of things with that we haven't actually seen the effects of yet, which is a scary thought, but we'll have to make up for it as well as we can. And if it comes to wrestling, I kind of feel like the audience, when the pandemic actually subsided, the audience was very hungry for the type of entertainment that wrestling can provide. That feeling of being a part of something and just joining the show in a way, because the audience is so important to make the product work when it comes to wrestling. If they're not in it, it's not the same. It's just not.
No, I saw some of these closed door things, and it just, yeah, it just was not as entertaining, because you needed that. You need yourself, like you're saying, the crowd needs to be there, and you need to feed off their reaction as well, because you don't know if you're doing your job right if nobody's doing anything in return to yay or boo as well. When it came to your look, because we're all over the place already, but when it came to your actual look, was it just a natural progression from what you would naturally have for your MMA background, like the taped up ankles and feet, no boots and all that? Was that just most comfortable for you, or did you try boots and were like, no, kind of thing? How did you kind of shape your look?
But a lot of the, but what, if you put it this way, when I started my first couple of matches, I actually had more Muay Thai gear, the shorts, the sports tops. I've always gone barefoot. I did training for the first couple of months with boots, like boxing boots, and I just felt super uncomfortable. And I was like, do I have to wear these really? And I was like, if you can manage to do everything everyone else can without, doesn't matter. But it hurts being barefoot sometimes. It's not always fun. If you take bumps, for example, and like you hit the feet, which happens all the time, you get stepped on. The ropes feels very different if you don't have the sole of a boot. So it's not always fun, especially not if it's cold floors and people spilling beer and you're outside the ring and so on. It's a lot of things for that people don't actually think about. But I don't think I would be I would not be comfortable putting on boots now, I don't think. I've gone so long now without just being barefoot, and obviously with the martial arts as well. Like, it feels wrong to kick someone in the face with the shoe. I don't know why. It feels much nicer barefoot, doesn't it?
I'll take your word for it. Not that I get kicked that often, unless it's my 1-year-old, and I can deal with that. But it just sounds like, again, that your tolerance for pain, because even though it's not always a physical sharp pain when walking around in sticky floors, but it's still an uncomfortable pain that's going on. So the more that we speak, the more that I'm thinking, yeah, I couldn't do any of this. So I'm quite happy. I'll stay this side. I'll stay this side of the microphone. Thank you, and I'll watch you guys do it instead.
I say stay tuned for the day I get booked in a hardcore match and someone brings the thumbtacks.
Oh
That's when I'm
God.
going to freak out.
Lego
Thankfully, it have not
thumbtacks.
happened yet.
Oh, you're just gonna give people ideas. I mean, 'cause I know that we do have we have. Looking sharp, he's already got a mention in this, but I know he's quite fond of a hardcore match, especially in Copenhagen Championship Wrestling. So you might just be giving him more ammunition here to throw out there. So speaking of 2021 now, so we spoke about ScandiGraps being a big opportunity. The next note I had was you had a match with Session Moth Martina, who was just off the back of, or still kind of in that interim period of being in Ring of Honor. She just kind of had a couple matches and then the world ended. So that's a pretty big opponent to have, especially for an opportunity to people to see you, much like Body Slam, but Martina's a huge name in wrestling, independent wrestling especially. Was that a match that, speaking of beer as well, is that a match that you're particularly proud of the opportunity, or was it just one of those nerve-wracking moments where you had to try and just get through?
I mean, she was amazing to work with. First of all, I really enjoyed that match for. I mean, I don't think it's my technically best match to date, but I had a lot of fun with it. So I'd say yeah, it was a big moment. It was also so good being off the just right after the ScandiGraps, having that kind of opponent. After that match, it's also got announced that it's going to be a women's championship coming up in Body Slam. So it was a big moment, I think, for women's wrestling in the Nordics as well, or in Scandinavia. So yeah, it was important that that match worked, and it was a lot of fun.
That's good.
Unfortunately, we had an injury in that match, though, which I'm kind of like, ugh, about. But apart from that,
I mean,
it was one of those good things.
I assume one of those matches with Martina is because I suppose a lot of wrestling is you do the moves and you're supposed to do them as well as possible and great, but a match with Martina is probably a bit more character based, character driven. You've got to kind of react to her shenanigans and all that kind of stuff. Is it? You did mention you watching a lot of wrestling during that time. Was that something that you were focused on in on just the character work, or did you
I
feel
mean,
like
definitely,
you did?
definitely, and it's also finding yourself as a wrestler, who you are in the ring. That's not an easy task, and I think that's also like a progress that takes time. And I don't think I'm there yet either. Obviously, working with someone that has a very clear gimmick and obviously a very comedic one as well, and very expressive. That was a really good learning experience because I hadn't done that many of those kind of matches at that point. But obviously, I mean, I had ideas to the table for that one as well. That obviously never happened. I would so have loved to have a drink off with Martina at the start, and just go like drunken master style. That's still something I'm like dreaming of doing at some point. I mean, I'm not saying I could pull it off, but it would be amazing to try.
I haven't seen or heard of Drunken Master for a very long time. That's I just
I mean, I didn't watch wrestling growing up, but I watched all of like the old martial arts movies. So yeah,
get your Jackie Chan things in and stuff like that just to kind of drive the
exactly.
ideas because off oh, if there's a guy whatever you can probably still do it now if there's a guy that could translate to wrestling that's it just to
Oh,
get a bit of,
in a
oh
heartbeat, no problems there.
amazing and then 2022 arrived and you had your well got written down as your UK debut for Wrestle Island so you was it just Sweden or Denmark as well and so the Nordics and Scandinavia that you were based in. Was this your first kind of outside of that, or did you get Germany just
No,
Europe though?
actually, it was not. I don't think I'd done Germany at that point, but I did do Belgium before the pandemic. I think that was the first one outside of the Nordic countries. Obviously, Sweden, Denmark, Finland. I've been to quite a lot and had at that point as well. But yeah, I think Belgium was my first down Europe. Then that was for Relentless. That is not a promotion anymore, unfortunately. But yeah, it was Wrestle Island was definitely my first in the UK, and it was one of the first. I mean, it was the first in the UK, and one of the first substantial bookings outside of Scandinavia. So that was a big deal as well.
And was one of
And
the
obviously, I'm
things. So I was going to say, what was one of the things where you felt like in that moment, even though you had goals and all that, was that a moment where you thought, okay, I think I could probably achieve all these things now that I'm getting booked in the UK, in Belgium, and just outside of the kind of wheel, the Scandinavian wheelhouse, you're kind of making your way out there.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, I've been looking at the UK scene for quite a while at that point. I was like, it would be fun to do something. I mean, I'm coming from a bit of a small region, so I don't expect to get flown in everywhere because it costs quite a lot of money and so on. And I didn't at that point, at least, at all. So everything's been very much like, oh wow, people actually want to pay for me coming in to wrestle. In different places. So yeah, I'm always very, very grateful that that's actually an opportunity to get around the world in this way. And I'm thinking as well, it's like if I didn't do wrestling, so many places, so many people I wouldn't have met or seen. It's baffling when you start actually thinking about it. And yeah,
Absolutely.
UK is obviously it's a big market for wrestling, and it's a huge deal. Wrestle Island has always been. I mean, I've been there twice. It's a super fun company to be at, and I have a lot of friends as well. working that scene. So
So it's
that was a really cool experience, just doing it for the first time and then being able to come back as well, obviously.
so is that just your first trip to UK and the UK in general, or it was have you been there before, or did you get a chance to have a look around anywhere, or was it just a case of you wanted to get in and just concentrate on
I mean, I've
doing
been to
your job?
UK before that for both for holiday and for martial arts, actually. I've been to quite a few martial arts camps in the UK. But this is wrestling is different. It's a different scene, different pulse to it as well. When you go on a trip to do a show, the pacing compared to anything else is so different, and how the interactions is going to be as well. And it's always a worry. You're in a new locker room, you don't know what rules apply, it's a new audience that might react to different things. It's always I mean, certain places I've been to, it's been very hard for me to read what is this audience gonna react to? What are they gonna think is interesting for a baby face, for example? What is the right type of approach to this? Or as a heel, depending on as well. So I mean, it's always it's nerve-wracking, but it's also extremely interesting, and it's so much fun.
Absolutely. I mean, as someone from the UK as well, we always think it's probably be a bit egotistical maybe, but you kind of think the UK is kind of the center of European wrestling, but it's probably a bit more Germany and all that kind of thing. But it's very interesting just to hear experiences from the likes of the Scandinavians or having that you don't have as much wrestling. So when you come over here, the fans are rabid and they get the opportunity to see wrestling almost weekly if they wanted to. No, it kicked me out this time. I'm back. Hello.
You're back. There you go. Now it
Okay.
seems very nice.
So that's fine. I've got a wee technical difficulties thing. I'll be fine. But yeah, so I was saying it must be just mad that people know who you are and you come to the UK and they've seen you wrestle. And they're able to know what you're gonna do at the same time. It must be just mind blowing.
It really, really is. I didn't expect that to have that in life, if you know what I mean. That came with wrestling, and I think, yeah, as I said before, I don't see any other scenario that would have been a thing for me. Even in martial arts, I trained a lot, and I obviously have several black belts and so on. But and since I never competed in it, it's not where I didn't compete at that level. Let's say I did a couple local things, and actually they get some bigger competitions, but not on the scale of obviously the UFC and so on. Yeah, just having people knowing who you are, and all of a sudden you're tagged in something like an article from Japan or a podcast from the US, or like you, for example, reaching out from Scotland, is like, can we do an interview? It baffles me, and I kind of hope it's gonna keep baffling me for the rest of my wrestling career. I don't want to be the person that feels like, oh yeah, obviously it's going to be like this. And I don't think I will be. I'm very grateful for the opportunities.
Absolutely. So, just going through our wee timeline here. There's quite a few matches that you had with Emerson Jane, of course, a big favorite for myself anyway. I'm a big fan of Emerson Jane, and including a little rivalry over the Body Slam, a women's championship that we mentioned a little bit ago. So she defeated you in a tournament final, and then a couple months later, you ended up defeating her for the title as well. So that whole experience then, so being in the final of the tournament for the title itself, and then having that little defeat as well, and then eventually overcoming Emerson Jane and becoming the champion, was that how was that for you?
I mean, she one of my favorite opponents ever. So extremely good in the ring, and I've learned so much from just working with her. So yeah, that was both the matches I had with her, some of my favorite ones, and I think they will be for, well, I mean, what do I know? Maybe for the rest of my life, because I really, really enjoyed working those matches. And I think the story, the build-up as well, like the tournament, obviously coming off still fairly fresh with the ScandiGraps, having the tournament for the women's belt. And because it was a lot of assumptions that I was just going to win it. I mean, I even had people walking up to me the day after. It's like, oh, congratulations. Like, I didn't win. You realize I did not win the belt. So it's a lot of people just assume that, yeah, of course that's going to happen. But yeah, she's amazing. She definitely deserved to be the first body slam women's champion. I can't say anything about that. Although I'm very happy I got the chance to win it back. Oh, I don't think I can hear you.
Oh no, it's fine. I was just listening. I was just listening,
Oh, sorry.
listening intently. So when, yeah, when it came to, it comes to winning the belt, though, as someone who came in a little bit later into, as I said, just came into wrestling through your background, was that as again? Is that, do you kind of think of it as a job well done? You get trusted with this belt, or are you the kind of person that's going to wear it out afterwards and celebrate you're the champ? How do you feel belts are in your opinion when it comes to wrestling?
I think, I mean, it's obviously a bit of duality to it, for obvious reasons, but it's an honor, I'd say. Any promotion that chooses to put a belt on anyone, that is a huge honor, and it's something they trust you with giving that championship match. They trust you with being able to carry that, and obviously, if you get the belt, to carry the championship for that promotion, that is not something you should take lightly, I think. And even more so if it's like, for example, body slam, because body slam is not my original promotion. It's close by, but it's not the country I actually live in. They have to bring me in. They don't have to do that. They chose to do that. So that obviously means it means a lot. It's a lot of trust, and I mean, hopefully they feel at this point is well earned, but you want to you want to perform for that. You want to give them the product they want to get, obviously, or they're trying to get. And it's not always the easiest either. I've had a few different belts, and it's been very different circumstances, stories around them as well. I think the Body Slam one is still the one I might be holding most dearly. I had that for quite a while now. I still holding it. So yeah, that was really big turning stone, I'd say. First with the ScandiGraps, then coming into the women's champion, and then the story is still going on. And I mean, I had other feuds for it. I still kept on to it. So see what the future brings. But hopefully good opponents. That's also the thing with carrying a belt, because the championship belt needs to be defended against people of the level that could possibly take the belt, right? So you get a lot of interesting matches that way. Which is as a wrestler, that is worth so much for your own development and for as I said, I'm still fairly new in this. I'm still learning, and you learn so much from these kind of matches.
So coming to that then, 2022, I'm still in that year, and it seems to be that seems to be your breakout year, I would say, between the end of the year being ScandiGraps, but 2022, just going through your list of opponents that you were having, including making your debut in WXW in Germany. You had matches with like Killer Kelly, Masa Slamovich, and you were in the Femme Fatales 2022, which you won as well. So that, and then you were 5 months as WXW Women's Champion. So that's is Germany's WXW kind of now, I know, your second, third home that you've got going, with Body Slam being your second and your actual home being your first. So how is it like being in WXW?
Oh, I mean, it's also, as I said, it's such an honor to be brought in somewhere and be put in those kind of matches and with those opportunities. And I'm so grateful for everything they've done for me in this. I mean, I'm thinking, because I've been a lot to Germany for a while now, and we'll see what's going to happen going forward, obviously. New champions now. I don't think I will challenge for that belt in the near future, but who knows? I reckon that's not going to be in the ballpark right now, but I have my eyes on a few different markets, so we'll see what's going to happen. But yeah, Germany's been amazing, and like the fans there are, I mean, it's the same that's when you come to the UK as well, it's like the fans there know wrestling. And we have amazing, amazing crowds in Scandinavia, but they're not wrestling fans necessarily. Obviously, you have wrestling fans as well, but they're there to see a spectacle. They're there to see a show. They're there to have fun. They're there to scream at the wrestlers. But yeah, you have a different type of vibe in both Germany and the UK when people understand the product in a different way, which is challenging in a lot of ways, especially if you're used to very rowdy crowds, like people that just throws glasses and screams and just like living their best life kind of on the side of the ring. But I enjoyed that as well, and especially the contrast. You can learn a lot from that as well and say, okay, these kind of interactions, what can I do with that? What do I need to do? And how do I need to think about my own being or my own character to make it work for this setting? Because it is different. And the first time I came across that in Relentless in Belgium, I was terrified. It was a quiet audience, and there obviously wasn't an audience. It was the first wrestling show in Belgium, at least for a very long time. I don't know if it was the first one ever, possibly. So it wasn't a crowd that was used to those kind of to that kind of show. But so everyone was kind of like freaking out. It's like, well, what's going on? Are we doing the right thing? And then people coming up afterwards and like, oh, this was great and loving this and that. And then you're starting to understand that, okay, it's just different ways of being depending on like the culture is different or the how you think about how you should react in a wrestling match, the type of fans. So it's I like puzzles, and it's kind of a puzzle still.
So from there, we'll kind of we're just about at Copenhagen Championship Wrestling just this past weekend as of recording. But I'll just again go through your list of opponents. Luke Sharp, who is third mention of the show. If you wrestled him in July, you've had matches with Regina Rosendahl, who again we've had on the show before, pioneer in Finnish wrestling, women's wrestling especially. Former NXT talent, and I don't know how to say it, Amali. Is that Amali? A male?
Amal, I think.
Amal? Amal. So
Think.
you've.
Sorry if I'm wrong.
That's all right. I've butchered that so many times, and that's why I was going to hesitate for a moment before I actually said it. And then, like I mentioned, Killer Kelly, Maslanovic. So you've had a big roster of top quality wrestlers that are worldwide known through NXT or TNA or, sorry, Impact. I'll never get used to that. Impact Wrestling, AEW. But now you're in Scotland, of course, the most important of the accolades there. So Copenhagen Championship Wrestling, you had a four-way Femme Fatale, four-way Lexi Lux, Ruby Roberts, Daisy Jenkins, a Scottish crowd. I mean, the English crowd's fine, they're all good, but a Scottish crowd's a bit special. What was it like just having that experience for Copenhagen Championship Wrestling and just what we thought of the match itself as well?
I mean, obviously, it's super, super exciting to be in a new territory. I mean, four ways are hard. That's a hard match to get right. So I'd say I had a lot of fun with it. The match in itself, I'd say it was maybe not a perfect match, but like I said, a lot of fun. It definitely had moments. And I hope it's going to be memorable for the audience. Really fun audience as well. And that's something I'm not so used to actually, like the mix with adults and children, which I think is super cool. I wish we did that more around here. But it's usually alcohol sales, and you can't, age groups and so on. There's a lot of rules and regulations around that in Scandinavia, which is not bad, but. No, it's super fun having like the family crowd, and there's a church as well, which is unusual. It's not the first time I wrestled in a church, but it's quite unusual to have that opportunity. It's a really cool venue. Yeah, no, I was really happy to be able to be there, and obviously Scotland as well. I mean, I met Molly Spartan. I never worked with her, but I met her. Had a seminar with her in Finland. She's also like person I would love to meet in the ring one day, and there's others as well. It's like it's so much talent, so it's I'm really hoping to be able to tap into the Scottish market a bit more. And I must say, I really enjoyed. I stayed a couple extra days as well. And I mean, everyone's just lovely. And I stayed in Edinburgh for an extra day yesterday. That's why I came home like an hour before we started this. No, I've had a really good time. Amazing trip.
As someone who I'm getting from our chat here, you're quite studious when it comes to you'd like to scope out where you are. Is there anywhere else in Scotland that you kind of got your eye on, like a, I don't know, like a Discovery Wrestling or something like that? Just or ICW. Is there anywhere else that you're maybe wanting to pop into? Iron Girders for Molly Spartan, for example. Is there anywhere else that you've had your eye on?
I mean, I'd say the promotion in itself, if it's an interesting match and an opportunity to meet new people, I'm up for anything. All challengers accepted kind of thing. But yeah, I definitely, I mean, Iron Girls would be amazing. ICWs, obviously. I mean, I met quite a few, like Leighton Bussett, for example. He's even been to Sweden, but I met him in WXW as well, and so on. So many great people coming from this region. I have to be honest, I'm not sure exactly about all the different promotions around. I know there's quite a few, but there's so much talent, so much opportunities that, yeah, just hoping to get the foot in somewhere and have some fun. Have some fun with the audience as well, and hopefully have the character to grow here a bit more. Obviously, when you walk in as a character that's not, people maybe not as introduced to, and being in the same match as Stacey, for example, that is such just lovely personality and just bubbles up in the ring as well. It's super fun.
Excellent. All right, so we've got a bunch of questions in that from Instagram, a couple. None of it's wrestling related, so we'll just go through them as we kind of wrap up here. But first question, I'll get you through our ones first. First question I ask everyone is, what's your favorite dinosaur?
Oh, okay. I have not got that one before.
That's what you get on this podcast.
Maybe Velociraptor, possibly.
Okay.
I think that's pretty cool.
Another question you'll probably never had unless you spent any time with the crew at Copenhagen. What would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Sorry, could you repeat that?
What would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
Oh, okay. I'd say the cow, probably.
That's right. That's the question. That's the one that's going to be in the brain for the rest of the day. That's the one that you're going to come back to. But that's fine. Another one for the cow. Cows get quite popular this season, for whatever reason. I'm still on the side of the sheep, but I'm from the northeast of Scotland, so that's probably for different reasons. So Instagram, we've got, again, none of these are wrestling related, but we'll plow ahead. We've got Stone Malone asking, what's your favorite McFlurry? I'm sure you're not a McFlurry person, are you?
Oh, flurry, like the drinks, right?
Oh, the McDonald's ice cream.
Oh, I have to be completely honest and say I very rarely do McDonald's. We have other more local chains here that I'd rather go to.
I was gonna say, I've seen you're very much in shape. I would be surprised if McDonald's went near you for a while. I'm a different shape. McDonald's gone to me probably looks like every day, but so.
I mean, if I can imagine, they have like caramel, chocolate, strawberry, something like that, right?
Yeah.
If I were to choose, if I felt like a treat, I'd probably go for the caramel one.
Okay, that's fair. Good choice. And he's also asked, who's your favorite Avenger?
Oh, I mean, that's an interesting one. I want to say Black Widow on that one. Because who doesn't like a girl that kicks ass, right?
Fair, absolutely fair. And Ian Skinner, don't know if you're aware of Ian Skinner. He's a very interesting individual in the world of wrestling. He's, again, not wrestling related. He's just put Borat or Austin Powers.
Oh, okay. I'd say Austin Powers, maybe.
He's gonna like that answer because. if you haven't followed Ian Skinner, probably best to, because he's out there. But he keeps going on about setting up a promotion called Austin Powers Pro Wrestling, and it'll just be all the characters are Austin Powers based. So now you've picked Austin Powers, he'll probably tap you up to, I don't know who to play.
Brilliant. I'm looking forward to it.
It's one of those things that will never happen, but it seems to be a plan that comes by every so often that he thinks of it.
I
So yeah.
honestly think though it should be more wrestling promoters. There is a bit like out there with like weird concept. Just throw it out there and see what sticks. I mean, Shikara was running for quite a while, regardless of what you want to say about well, I mean, regardless of what happened later and what came out, obviously, but the idea, but like its own universe and with all the weird stuff and like everything goes as long as like consistent. I quite like that.
Yeah, it's just, I mean, wrestling at the end of the day is, it's supposed to be for the main source of income will be parents taking their kids. That's the kind of the main source of income wrestling generally is. So you've got to remember that. I mean, I'm 33 now, and I'm very aware that if I go to a wrestling show, I am not the target market. I am, but I'm going to enjoy myself anyway, kind of thing. But that's just the fun of wrestling. So one day
Wrestling
maybe.
is for everyone, though. I mean, it's just you might need to learn to enjoy it in a way. If you're not exposed to it, you might have preconceptions, but it really is for everyone. It's like the basic elements of storytelling in a very dynamic way.
Okay. Yeah. Yeah. That's fair. Absolutely fair. I'm just there to yay and boo. That's pretty much my modus operandi when it comes to wrestling now. Which I'm happy with
That's still so
after
fair.
years. Yeah. I've been watching it for 20 years. At the end of the day, I'm not there for nuance. I'm there for don't subtly tell me. Just tell me. I'm cool. I'm sold. I've bought a ticket. I'm sold in wrestling. It's fine. So as we wrap up here, I think my internet decides it wants to unalive itself. So we'll kind of try and move towards the end. Who's we mentioned promotions, and that's not kind of your first and foremost thought. It's more of the opponents that you want to get in the ring with. You mentioned Ollie Spartan, and you had your matches with Emerson and Ruby Roberts and Daisy Jenkins and Lexi Lux recently. Is there anyone that's of male or female that's of interest to you right now that you think, I think I'm ready to face that person? I think we could make something interesting.
Oh, you mean in general or
Go general. I mean, the forbidden door, quote unquote, is open. You can get anyone in the world. Shayna Baszler's available. You get Shayna Baszler. You can get Ronda Rousey. Who you wanting? Who's on your Cody Rhodes list of opponents?
I mean, it's gonna be a very, very long list that we're not gonna have time for, I think. I mean, it's so many wrestlers I would love to face. And obviously, depending on you see them doing a match and scouting and like, oh, after that match, this opponent would be like, I would absolutely love that. But something that I would be ready for today, that makes it a little bit harder. I was really actually hoping to get a match with John Akai. I'm actually going to the US in September, so that was something I was really, really hoping for. That's not going to be available though; she's in Japan. But hopefully, some other time. That would be a really exciting match to have, I think. Very similar styles, so it could be interesting. Also, I mean, there's so many. There's obviously I do a lot of intergender matches as well, and it's like also so many cool opponents to have, both in Scandinavia and around the world. I mean, I would love to work with Shige, for example, Shigehiro Ida from Japan as well, was the former WXW champion. That would just be amazing because he's phenomenal in the ring. We'll see what the future brings. It's a vast world.
That's
And yeah,
it.
it's
Yeah.
I mean I would pick like I think at least 5, 10 people out of every promotion if I got a chance, because there's so much to learn and so many different style to try to like figure out. So it's such a hard question.
And because, like you say, you're kind of in your rookie years as well, that you've your back catalogue of opponents, though phenomenal so far, it's still quite limited in who you've actually faced. So there's a wide ocean out there, and you've just got your net trying to catch them as you can, kind of thing. So
Really is.
which I'm sure is not going to be impossible. I'm sure by the time if we ever catch up in a year or two down the line, your back catalogue of opponents will be even larger, and your title trophy cabinet will be even more bursting. Although I don't know how it works, you've got to put back the belt afterwards. You don't get to keep it or a replica or anything. But no, this has been a great chat. I mean, also dog collar match I would bring up, but like I say, I'm very aware of my internet is being very shocking at the moment. So I'm just gonna let you go for the rest of your afternoon, let you recover from traveling, and actually give you a bit of time to yourself. But thank you very much for joining me. Where can people find out more about Aliss Ink?
I'd say I'm obviously you can find me on Instagram. It's my main social media, so to speak. But I'm also on Twitter and Facebook. So Aliss Ink. And also quite a few YouTube matches available if anyone feels like they want to search for it. They have
Excellent.
the name
No,
there. Go on, I'm prepared.
nobody plugs going to YouTube and watch their matches. That's hopefully a trend that continues. But perfect. Well, thank you very much for taking the time to speak to me. Hopefully everyone's going to be buying your merch, and you'll be back to Scotland soon enough as well. But no, have a great rest of the day.